Hello, everybody. Today's day 157, making Songbringer, and I'm working on item crafting still. Yesterday, it was mostly the code to get it all done, so I will demonstrate the code. I did a lot of refactoring last night with the actual properties of items, so they're going to be a lot easier to maintain those properties from now on. So here's the screen we've got set up. So the code's all done. Today, I'm going to be working on art. And so if I, these are both actually, this one is a, this boot right here is actually a blink, and this boot right here is actually fire. So if I throw down the boot and the, throw down the other boot, or the blink and the fire basically, it combines it into this fire orb. And then when you go out of this room, you can actually use it. There we go. So that's the code end of it all. And now I'm just going to go jump right into doing art for it all. So I really want to take this whole scene that we're looking at right here and change all the graphics. So this is actually going to be a robot guy. He's called the Droid Smith. And he is what, he'll look a lot different. So he'll actually be a robot. He'll be behind a counter of some sort. You'll be able to place the items actually on the counter, so you, and they can only go, they can only be placed in a certain point, so like they'll, you can only place the item there and there. What's up, Mars Power? Howdy. Yeah, so let's get working on these graphics. I just noticed that I could make this doorway entrance a lot better, this graphic. So Graphics time, art time, daytime, art time. Yeah, why is it a great day today? Where's the door light? Ooh. Nice, that sounds fun. What'd you end up doing with your messing with them? Level, door light, north, south. Hi, Pema. Ooh, nice. The creative infinity. Create, destroy. Create, destroy. Destroy, create. Construct, destruct. Oh, I think it actually is door light south I'm talking about. Maybe not. Okay, let's look for door light. I realized how to make door lights really smooth, or basically when you're doing a blur, you can use 16-bit color, and it really improves things. Yeah, door light south. What's this one? Oh, this is totally different. Door light south one. That's for the actual door tiles. I'm talking about this different one here. Ah. That sounds cool. Is it going to save you some time down the road, or just going to make things better? Oh, there it is. Sheets, rocks. So would it be in sprites, rocks? Yeah, there it is. There's two door souths. Okay, so if we zoom in on this, we can just see right away that this is going to be really, or if we add a black background, we can see, we can expose the badness. So that's how, look how crappy that looks. We're going to make this better right now. Kind of wondering how I did it though, how I created this the first time. Oh no! Oh, this sucks, Azurus. What, is pixel art really your thing? Or would you rather be doing some other kind of art? And have you checked out this one article? One sec. Cool, yeah, at least more reliable. That'll definitely save you some time down the road. Once your code's more reliable, your backend's more reliable and all that, infrastructure stuff. Azurus, have you seen this? The book from programmer to artist thing? I've mentioned it on several streams, so Azurus, if you haven't seen that, that might help out. That's what I thought too when I first started. Okay, so this image, I'm going to take its mode and put it up to 16 bits per channel. And you can already tell it looks a lot better. What if I put it to 32 bits per channel? No, that doesn't even help. Weird. Okay, so let's put it to 16 bits per channel. And let's see if recreating it can help. It's almost like I used like a circle or something. Okay, I'm gonna take a totally white color. Do a new layer. I'm gonna do a circle. Something like this. And then I'm going to squish it down. Hey, what's up, Creeper? Yo, I'm working on the art today for the item crafting guy. Yeah, crafting thing's already working. Let me show you. So the code's done, but now I'm working on the art for the item crafting. So let me show you how this works. Basically, you drop two items, and this item crafter guy will craft them. So I've still got to do all the visuals. So this is totally not how it's going to look. But so here's the blink, and here's the fire item. I haven't drawn those two items, so just use the boot. So if I drop the blink and I drop the fire, he combines them into the fire orb. So yeah, the code's all done. Now I just got to hook it up and make sure, you know, do all the art better. So this is the first pixel art you ever made. Because I really don't think it's that bad, man, for your first art. You should look back at my project, too, when I first started all this. Like, the art wasn't that great then, and it got better and better. Yeah, but you can do that in code, too. So you can, like, draw things sort of bland and then use a nice shader or whatever to make it look better. I always rely on that, you know? The shader somehow makes everything look so much better. Yeah, Marzo, exactly. So you have to go to this guy to be able to craft. And when you're crafting, it changes the rules about your inventory screen. So normally your inventory screen shows items that you can equip and also passive items. So, and then once you go to the item crafter guy, It changes everything. So you can't use your sword, you can't use items. In fact, if you do use your sword, it drops it. So whatever item you use, you drop. And then if you can't combine them, there's going to be some kind of like visual thing, like it'll show you that you cannot combine two items. Hey, what's up, Momir? All right, so I'm just recreating this door light graphic because I learned how to do 16-bit color channels and it really helped. Yeah, sometimes I do earlier streams because of the guys there in Europe and, you know, the Middle East and stuff like that. It's really late for them all the time, and there's so many people that watch from Europe. So I try and do some earlier streams a few times a week. Okay, so I'm going to duplicate this layer and then blur it and see if we can get approximately the same kind of Gaussian blur off of that. Oh, yeah. Wow, that's pretty good right off the bat. Yeah, see, look how much smoother that is. Wow. Yeah. And just to mess with you. What's up, Nostrobot? Oh, cool. So I hope this is better for you then, to have it a little earlier. Yeah, Azenris, right now if you leave on it while it's on the floor, you'll actually have lost that item. But I'm going to make it so when you leave, I'm going to do some kind of special logic in the gear component so that it's not that you're dropping the item and you're actually discarding it. It's that it marks it as being crafted. So if you leave the crafting room, it'll go back into the gear component. And anything that is being crafted, it will take it back into your inventory. And there's a, you know, it's lucky that as you're leaving this room, it fades to black. So it can kind of explain that, yeah, maybe your character went back and picked those up, those items or whatever. Cool. Yeah. Nice. Isn't it crazy how something simple can be better? You know what I mean? Like you're just saying that, you know, you like this even though it's simple. And it's true. I like it too. It's crazy cool how that happens. How simplicity can become beauty. Nice. Right on. Well, cool. I'm looking forward to seeing how that turns out. Yeah, exactly. Like VVVV. Totally. Good example. Awesome game. And a lot of his games too. Terry Kavanaugh does that with a lot of his games. Like Don't Look Back is also a lot like that. Don't Look Back is so good. I guess it's called Game. Oh, there it was. Don't Look Back, Terry. Yeah. Don't Look Back, same kind of thing. Super, super simple art. Look at this. If you guys haven't played this game, this is classic. You got to play this game. And it's only like 20 minutes long to beat the game. But literally amazing. Like so awesome how he did this game. Nice. What's up, Mr. Sniffles? How long until I can start with C++? Man, if you want to start with C++, just start with C++. You don't need to learn Python. I was just recommending that for people that that were brand new and had, you know, and were wondering where to start. If I were you, I would recommend starting to learn C first. So it's, you know, a little bit simpler than C++, and you'll get a lot of the basic concepts that you're going to learn into C++ anyways. And I recommend this book called Learn C the Hard Way, which is You know, it's a joke. It's not actually the hard way. Oh, you can walk around? Oh, nice. Yeah, totally. I know how you feel. When I first started coding, like 20 years ago, I always looked up to people that could make music. I'm like, oh my God, it's so cool that they can make music, art too. I'm like, oh my God, they make good art. And I thought I could never do it. I'm like, you know what? I'm just a programmer. That's my talent. My talent's programming. I'll never be a good artist. And I thought this up until about 5 years ago, and I finally changed my mind. I'm like, you know what? Maybe I could at least buy an art tablet. And I bought the art tablet, and it sat there for an entire year. I never used my art tablet. And then finally I picked up the art tablet and I tried it. And I'm all, you know what? This isn't that hard. It was hard to get used to how the pen works at first. But then once I got used to it and started making more and more art, I started getting good at it. And now I'm confident. So, you start with Pascal? Nice, right on. Yeah, and if Java's your language too, stick with that one, man. Yeah. You're at this point right now where you're gonna find a language that resonates with you. Like you're gonna be like, yeah, I like this. I like this language. I like the way it works. I understand it, you know what I mean? And then just run with that, you know? Really, once you get sort of good at one language like C++ or Java or C Sharp or whatever it is, it's really all you need to know. You don't really need to learn every language there is. One language can do, you can do pretty much everything in one language. As far I'm talking about games, you know what I mean? Like Java, there's Java game engines. C++, there's lots of C++ game engines. C Sharp, there's Unity, you know. Ruby, yeah, Ruby. I've heard great things about Ruby. I never quite learned it myself. Nice, right on. All right, let's see. We got how many pixels on the right? 74, 76. So this needs to go one pixel. Cool. Yeah, I know. And this just goes to show we all have languages we resonate with, you know? For some of us, we hate Pascal. For some of us, we love Pascal. Let's do a little more blur. Do 20s. Yeah, a little less. About like that. So let's compare this to the other one. The other one looked like this. That's what the door light was. Look how dirty it is. Here's the new one. So much cleaner. I'm gonna start with. I added sort of a yellow light to it because I wanted it to seem like sunlight. So I think I'm gonna do that. Stick with this hue here. This is hue 59. And I'm just gonna do a saturation layer to saturate it to that color. Colorize 59, saturation way less. Trying to emulate sunlight here. In fact, I'm gonna go way less, more like yellow than green there. That's better. There, so it's just kind of has a tiny tint of warmth. All right, let's re-export this and see if the door light looks better now. So what I did here is I basically just used 16 bits per channel to, and then did the Gaussian blur, and it made that blur turn out so much better. So now that it's like that, we should be able to put it in the game, and it ought to look a lot cleaner. Yep. Hello, Hyrule Spy. Yeah, it can be. It can be. It depends on where you're at mentally learning that language, but I know what you mean. That's why I recommend C to start with, because you're not learning object oriented at first. But pointers can be kind of a difficult thing to learn. Look how much cleaner that is. Heck yeah. Awesome. It's a bit too bright, actually, because I don't want it to overwhelm and look like the player is like standing on the light. It should if it's that bright, it should be lighting up the player as well. So let's compare it comparatively. This light brightness was about 74, and this light brightness is now 82, so let's turn it down. 76, couple more. 79, what? Oh, this is okay, it's the one on the right. What the heck is that number on the left then? 71. There, 74. Okay, let's try that. Yeah. Huh. Interesting. True. Yeah, unless you're using a really like a garbage collected language. But then, I guess if you don't really understand like memory at all, I know what you mean. Yeah, you're gonna make a lot of mistakes, even with the garbage collected language. Yeah, I like it, but I'm gonna go a little darker actually. Let's bring this back down to like 16 instead of 11. Yeah, that's good. Man, that's so much better. Awesome. Okay. All right. Now on to drawing some items and stuff. I'm going to start drawing the items that you can craft first. I'm going to put the player right there in that room too, so to save some time. I think it's 0, 0, negative 2, 0, 1. Oops. Yeah, there we go. Cool. Yeah. Okay, so drawing. Right, so I'm gonna draw something fire-like. Fire inside a cube, I'm thinking. Turn off these slices. All right. So let's grab the approximate cube size. I'm going to do something like that. Let's duplicate the bomb container. All right, so we've got a bomb container. Thinking it should be like a real low opacity. So it's sort of a translucent thing. And then we'll do on the inside, we'll do some fire. All right. Let's see how this one looks. I'm going to add a new layer base slice. Call this one fire. Call it item fire, actually. I want to see if this how this looks with that translucency before I do anything more with this one. And this goes in sheets, HUD, oops. I forgot to do. Yeah, okay, we got the right folder, but I gotta do this all user slices, very important. All right. Oh. Stupid Italy. What's up, Italy? Come on, internet. Yeah, you didn't miss much. I'm just drawing, that's all. Yesterday I did this cool thing though. I put all of the items properties into this big old map so that it's a lot more organized now. If I want to go and update the sword, everything for the sword is in one place. The key that it uses for the text to load it, the item frame that it uses, the color it should be to have a glow if it's an item on the ground, the minimum quantity you can possess of it, the maximum quantity, flags for it, like whether it's equipable, craftable, passive, a trigger, and also the price. So everything you would need for a single item is all in the same place on one single line, and that way it's just super easy. When I add an item, I know exactly where to go. I know exactly what things I need to set for it. So let's see what that looks like with the fire item. Oh, yeah, I do. Electric cow. Yep. These are the ones I've heard. I learned C++ like a lot of years ago, and so the book I learned from doesn't exist anymore. But But here's one. And I think there's is there a learn C++ the hard way? I guess there's not really a there's learn C the hard way, but there's no learn C++ the hard way. I guess there's only C for this one. But there's this one. I've heard this one's good too. Might be a good start. Yeah, you're welcome, man. Good luck, by the way. Good luck. And feel free to come back and share what you're learning. And if you're having any trouble or whatever, I'd be glad to help. And I'm sure there's other people here on this stream that would be glad to try and help you too. All right. Okay. Was that there? Did I miss that? Okay. Yeah, all right, cool. We've got fire. All right, it's a bit too translucent. Let's see what it looks like with a little more translucency or a little more opacity. Let's put all the way to 50. But I kind of want it to like, so we use lighter color? Yeah, that's what I want to do. I want to see the fire showing through. A lighter color worked good. Maybe screen would work too. Screen's kind of cool. Adds a little bit of, I don't know how to describe it. All right, so let's export this. Oh, did my pen just die? Come on, pen. Stay with me, pen. Stay with me, R tablet. Yay. Super glue is not holding up very well. Really? What's up, Uhu Boss? Yeah, I'm working on the artwork for item crafting. Oh, yeah, cool. Oh, check it out. Here, there is a one on. Oh, cool. I'm totally going to recommend this website from now on. This is great. Look how many, like, references they have to all these languages. Buy a t-shirt, asshole. This is so great. Cool, I'm gonna remember this programming. Oh, yeah. Well, if it's your first language, man, you're gonna get it. I know what you mean by it can be a little annoying sometimes. Just keep going. Make a little progress every day, you know what I mean? And before you know it, you'll know this language. It's like it may seem kind of complex at first, but it's really not too bad. Did I export that? I think I did. So all I'm trying to do here is draw fire that's contained in some sort of container, I was gonna call this item fire in a bottle. I'm not sure if that's the right name for it. Yeah, that's kind of cool. I like it about like that. I guess one thing that would be cool is if it was animated. Okay, well, that's good to know. I'm not going to worry about making it animated at first. Okay, so next thing, I want to do a clear orb And this is going to be the teleport orb. And when you get this orb, you can teleport with it. But once you get the fire teleport, then you can teleport while turning into fire. So I think it should look kind of like this ice one, but more just desaturated. Wolski, what's up, Wolski? Howdy, man. Oh, electric cow. Yeah, I'll break this down for you kind of how it works. Basically, here in Photoshop, I'm using slices to export all these things. So these little blue lines here represent slices. And if I select this tool here, it's called the Slice Select tool. And I can double click on a slice and name it something. So I'm going to name this one item blink. And then when I go and export, so I do a save for web, and you can specify. See, look at this. All these slices are being exported as separate frames. And so I go and I select the folder that I want them to all be exported as. And I make sure and do all user slices, not all slices, because I don't want the empty areas in this document to become slices. So all user slices, and then when I export, it's gonna export all these separate ping files like bomb zero, bomb one, the bomb container, the boot, cactus, all this stuff. So that exports all the ping files. Once the ping files have been exported, then there's this thing called texture packer. Texture packer takes all of the ping files and it puts them all into a single texture. And so check us out. Look how many, this is all the sprites in just this one texture. There's a lot of sprites in this texture, but it packs them all in really efficiently. And so that you're using the minimum amount of texture memory for all this. And then once it's been exported as a texture, then you, check it out. Look what it does once it's in a texture. Here's the sprites.pbr.ccz. This is the actual graphic that gets exported. And then there's also this, sprites.plist. This is a list of all the sprites that are within that texture. So the game engine I'm using, Cocos2DX, actually loads this plist file, parses out all of these different sprite frames that are within that texture. And then, like, for example, Bike Crash. This is at offset 0, negative 4. The frame is 38 pixels wide, 40 pixels tall, and it's at 249,1116. So the game engine uses this file to parse out all those files, even though it's only using one texture. And so that's kind of how you do it. Does that make sense? Does that kind of like answer your question? Crazy internet. Oh man, Marza, sorry about that. What happened to my pen? Come on, pen, stay with me. Electric Cow, no, it's not a C++ library that accesses property lists. It's a game engine that has a specific part of that game engine which loads the property lists. And the game engine is called Cocos2DX. This is what I'm using. It's cocos2dx.org. And this on Macs, it uses the built-in Mac libraries to process the property list. On Windows and all that, it uses an XML parser because plist files are XML if they're saved as such. Yeah, Licarno, I hope that made sense. Like, maybe some of you guys are actually all curious about that. Yeah, totally. Yeah, Unity has their own sprite sheet packer thing. But if you're not using Unity, you're gonna have to do it yourself somehow. And texture packer is awesome because You could do it on the command line. So I actually have a script which runs every time I run the game, it runs this script which automatically packs all the textures. So you can actually see I can call texture packer from the command line. It loops over all the TPS files, which are the texture packer files, and then updates them. And if there's no changes, if there's been no new ping files exported, it doesn't have to repack the texture. But if it detects that even one of the ping files has been updated, it just automatically updates the texture. So really, really easy. And that way I don't have to do it by hand every time I run the game. Super cool. Yeah, Wolski, I've been awesome, man. Yeah, totally awesome. Just, I get to do my favorite thing every day. I get to make games. I'm a very lucky man. My life is awesome. Yes, yeah. Essentially, they're within the plist file. See, this plist file is XML. Let me show you. If I do this, I can go view as. I can open. I can view this plist file as pure source code, and you're going to see that it actually is XML. So if I was on Windows or whatever, I could actually go and edit this by hand if I wanted. You don't need this Xcode editor, but the Xcode editor is nice because it can view this pure source code as an actual property list, and then I can, you know, edit it like I would, you know, any other property list, which is just handy, but not necessary. Yeah, Nostrobot, you can do that with Texture Packer. Check it out. In Texture Packer, you can specify, like, oh, okay, here's my texture. Here's where, okay, I want to extrude each sprite by a pixel. In between each sprite, I want to have 2 pixels padding. Maybe on the border, I want to have, like, 4 pixels or whatever. You can change all these options. You can specify the maximum size for the texture. You can specify the pixel format. You can specify how it packs it. Everything is there in Texture Packer. And then once I just save this project, then my script takes over and does the rest. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. It's a fundamental thing to game development today. Today you use things like sprite texture packers. Back in the day when I started writing games like 20 years ago, we had nothing like this. There was nothing this awesome. So you had to do it all by hand and it was really hard. But now we've got so many great tools that make your life so easy. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. You have to click that show advanced options thing. Yeah. Okay, so going back to drawing an orb for the blink. This blink orb, I want it to desaturate this so it's grayish. I'm going to flip it too. And take its mode adjustments, just turn down the saturation. Actually, I think I'm gonna color it something, maybe purplish. Yeah, slightly purple. Now I'm gonna mess with it a bit because it looks too much like the ice. Still trying to get it to look distinct. Yeah, that's better. A little better. Well, let's work on the edge a little bit too. like that. Yeah, oh yeah, that actually did work. Okay, cool. I like that edge. All right, cool. Now we've got a teleport orb to start with. Yeah, I've made other games before this, but this is the most successful game so far I've made, at least as far as a marketing standpoint. So my last game I made, this is a big lesson. I'm going to repeat this lesson because this is probably the most important thing I've ever learned in making video games. And it took me 2 years and, you know, 6 days a week making this game to learn this. But this is a pretty cool game, actually. I'm very proud of how we developed this game. It's called Hero Bash. My buddy and I made it. He did the art and the design. I did the game programming and the music and the sounds and all that. And it took us 2 years to make this game, and we never ever marketed it, so we never built the following at all. Because our plan was to make the game, make it perfect, and then release it and hire somebody to do the marketing for us. And we both had like $3,000. We're like, okay, we got $6,000. That's not very, you know, that's enough to get some marketing done, right? So we made this game. We made it perfect. It took us 2 years. We published our game on the iOS App Store, and we hired this PR firm to do marketing for us, and we paid them like $5,000. And literally, this game to this day makes about $20 a month. And the work the PR firm did was the most horrible work I've ever seen any company do. It was not worth $5,000 worth of money. We got like maybe 200 players or something like that total. We could have got that on our own, you know, without paying $5,000 to this company or whatever. So to this day, I'm still kind of pissed off about it. But anyways, I learned a big lesson there. And that's that when you're an indie developer and you're doing your own game, you're a solo developer. You have no name yet. You have no IP yet. You have nothing that's going to bring a following to your game. You got to start building a following from day one for your game. So it doesn't matter whether you just have no graphics at all, whether you just have a mock-up image. Start marketing your game from day one. Start posting on Twitter. Start posting here on Twitch or Tumblr or whatever. Build your following from day one. And that's what I've done with this game. It's turned out really well. Because I started building the following from day one, and 4 months later, I was able to do a Kickstarter campaign. The Kickstarter campaign kicked ass. That was like, I'm still amazed at how well that went, and still so grateful and humbled by how many people are liking that, you know, this project and stuff like that. So, sorry to rant on that, but it's a really, really important thing, and I like to tell people that story just to let you guys know to believe in yourselves and to market your games from day one. Nice, man. What's up, Ginger Kiwi? Yeah. Yeah, marketing companies are scary to me. But, you know, I think marketing's kind of easy now. As long as, like, you could just, like, make it as simple as just sharing a single screenshot of your game every day on Twitter. You know, it's not that hard. Share what you've done that day, even if it's just a tiny bit, even if you just barely made some progress on your game, share it on Twitter. You'll start building a Twitter following that way. And that's one simple way to build a following. Exactly, Momir. Yeah, that's how I think of it now. Yeah. In fact, I should think of it more like that, because I guess I just realized that I am kind of still pissed off about it. So yeah, we paid that money to teach ourselves a lesson. And in fact, that whole game was kind of a learning experience for me. Yeah, totally. Yeah. Like developing this game live on Twitch has probably been the best thing ever. Not only from your guys' encouragement and your suggestions and ideas, but also, you know, you've supported financially. I mean, that's huge, because I did not have the funds to actually do this myself. I would have had to go get a job, basically. And then this game would not be made full time and as fast as it is. So yeah, totally, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and my lesson I've learned about social networks too is that it's important to focus on the social network. If you're only posting on it and you're not really checking it, you're not really engaged in that social network, you're not going to see as many good results from it. I see really good results from Twitter because I use it all the time. And so if you're just like, if I tried this out, actually, when I first started doing this game, I did try out things like Buffer. So Buffer, you can use Buffer to post on multiple social networks at once. But I realized pretty quickly that I was posting all these images and stuff to Facebook. No one was checking them because I wasn't checking it myself. I wasn't actually engaged in that social network. So yeah, if Pinterest works for you and you love that site and you use it all the time, it probably will work really well for you and or your game or whatever. But that's the thing is, like, if you're trying to use a social network to build a following and you're not actually going to use that social network, or you're not going to hire somebody to use it for you or something like that, there's no real human presence there, it's probably not going to work that well, at least in my experience. So, okay, so we should have this this blink thing ready to go. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. When you use a social network, you have to use a social network, right? Okay, so we've got the blink orb. Let's hook it up to the item. All right, I think it was just called item blink. Cool. All right, we've got that. Oh, let's put some text behind them as well, so we know what the heck they are. Oh, cool. I know what you mean. When you feel like you love a social network, you probably do. So I think that's probably a great place for you to start if you're gonna, you know, build a following for your game. But I know what you mean, getting too ashamed to get started. Yeah, and yeah, I guess that's a good question. What are you ashamed of? Because I know what you mean. When I first started, I had so many different fears. And I guess, you know, shame is kind of, I guess you can consider it a fear. And I wrote an article about this. Maybe it can help. This is probably one of the best lessons I've ever learned. This is probably one of the most powerful things I've ever learned. Because this is what actually got me to do Twitch. This is what actually got me to do this game, even. I would have gave up on this game if I didn't have this technique. All right, Marza, good night, man. Yeah, true, right? Yeah. And at first, when you're streaming, you're not going to see that many people come on your stream anyways. So there's really not that much to be ashamed of. And also, you know, it takes time to build it up too. So like at first, you might not have that many people watching. But as you start doing it day by day, you'll build up that following on Twitch, and eventually you'll have so many people on there. It's like you'll never be lonely. You'll never worry about that. But maybe that article can help you with the shame part. I don't know. Okay, so let's give these items some text. There's the item blink. Which allows you to teleport forward a few steps. Yeah. Yes, please, somebody help Marzipower have a better internet connection. Yeah, right, I know. And I have them too. I had them for a long time, and they honestly almost stopped me from making this game. like little fears, like what if people steal my ideas? You know, what if somebody else takes everything, all the code I've written, all the graphics I've drawn, and makes the exact same game? And I finally realized that's just a silly fear. Nobody can actually do that. And in fact, when you share your ideas, they become like seeds. No seed grows into exactly the same tree. And it's the same thing. When you put energy into a game, you got to put like a year worth of time into a game. Nobody else is going to go put a year into this game and make it exactly like my game would have been. And besides, ideas are all, we all are taking ideas from each other. You know what I mean? All of our games are based on other games or other ideas and stuff. So, you know, I don't know. It's so easy to have those pointless fears, but once you get over them, you feel like a new person. You're like, you feel empowered, like crazy good. Oh, by the way, Ginger Kiwi, what's your game you're working on? Oh, no, definitely not. Yeah, I wouldn't put my game on the stock market or my company on the stock market. For one, my company's way too small to be put on the stock market. It's only one person, and I like it that way. Okay, we got item blink and item fire. Call this one the fire cube. Yeah, affiliate programs. I've tried these before. I had a my company, I used to make game engines, and so I learned a little bit about how the internet works, how you sell stuff on the internet and stuff. And I did some affiliate programs and they were okay, but that's not really how it works with game development, in my opinion. I don't know. Oh, you mean to actually like sell things on an affiliate program? Yeah, see, that's this is a really good question, Electric Cow. I think of it like this: when you have a choice in life of what you want to do with your life. You know what I mean? What you want to do with your skills? Like, for example, I love making video games, and yes, I could go and spend a lot of time creating a website about affiliate programs and things like that, and develop some income doing that. But would I really be making games at that point? No, I would not be making games at that point. In fact, you think that, oh, I can just set up this website with these affiliate things and yeah, I'll be making an income stream. And then I can go and spend my time making the game. Not true in my experience. In fact, whenever you make that choice to go do something else for money, like, okay, I'm going to go create this affiliate program, that affiliate program will become your life. It will take so much time. It'll take way more time than you think to keep that updated, to maintain it, and things like that. So I think of it like shooting an arrow. You know what I mean? It's like when you're shooting an arrow at a target, you want to hit the bullseye. And so for the thing is to identify what the bullseye is in your life. What is that bullseye? Is it making games or is it making an affiliate program? Because if you really want to shoot for games, but you change your aim a little bit and you go for the affiliate program, you're going to completely miss. And that's just how it is. You can't do two things. You can, or at least in my experience, I can only do like one thing well. And so that's why I could have made choices like this. I could have kept going with my game engine business, for example, but I chose instead to make this game full time and to let everything else go. And it was the best decision I ever made because it's now been funded on Kickstarter and I can do this full time and I don't need to worry about affiliate programs or game engines or making money in any other way. I could focus entirely on this. So that's a really good question. Very, very good question, because I myself have been sidetracked for at least a decade doing stuff like that. You know what I mean? I always thought, oh, I'll just do this little thing for a little while and then I'll make a game. It never ever happened for a whole decade. And so I hope that that life lesson also helps. Sometimes I talk a lot. I'm sorry if this is too much. Whoa, cool, Kiwi. Nice, man. Well, I can't wait to see some screenshots, man. Nice, you just played Don't Look Back? Right on. What's up, Code Sparrow? A lazy billionaire. Wouldn't that be nice? Nice, right on. Do I ever have to discipline myself to develop my skills instead of doing other things? No, because I don't know. I literally spend 6 or 7 days a week coding and at least 8 to 10 hours a day. So for me, it's like going out and doing concerts and watching TV and things like that is necessary. You know what I mean? It's like I have to force myself almost to go out to a concert or go out with friends or go get a drink or go watch some TV or whatever because I love doing this so much. So that's also, you know, a shortcut to success in life is doing what you love, because then you don't have to worry about these kind of things, you know? That's so cool. Such a rad concept, Kiwi. Yes, Creeper. Yeah. I said all that because, I mean, I've spent at least an entire decade doing that. And that's why you haven't seen me make games until now. I finally worked up the courage and said, you know what? No, I'm not going to try and do all these other things, because literally while I started this project, I was very tempted to do some web work and pay my bills. You know what I mean? I'm like, but no, I want to make this game and I want to do this. And if I had made that choice to actually put web work as my focus, this game would not be where it is today, and I wouldn't be doing this. Thanks, Nostrobot. What's up, Adavel? Okay, so while we're in this room, cool. Now we got this blink orb text. Teleport forward a few steps. And then we got the fire cube. Elemental fire and a convenient cube. Nice. All right, so if we combine the blink orb with the fire cube, he combines them, turns into this. All right, so we're good to go. Now what I want to start drawing is this whole scene. I want this to look totally different. So he's going to be a robot. He's going to be behind a counter. So I'm just going to start drawing it. I don't really know how this is going to turn out. I've been trying to visualize how art should be, or what I imagine for a piece of art, but it hasn't been working lately. Like the visuals, I only get tiny glimpses, and then when I suddenly start making the art, then it all comes together. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to let it all come together. This is a nice color actually for the background, but I'm going to take the saturation out. Okay, so let's start drawing this counter. What's this counter gonna look like? Right on, good. Yes, just do it. Yeah. What's up, Boden? Yeah, are you talking about that one actor guy? Somebody on the stream showed me that the other day. That was funny. So this game kind of has like a mix of sci-fi and fantasy visuals. So I'm actually gonna do, I think I'm gonna do this counter in stone. No, I changed my mind. I'm gonna do it in metal. So it's gonna look like metal. Yoda? No. Yes, Yoda. But the other, who's the other guy? This is actually kind of funny. Here it is, Shia LaBeouf. Oh yeah, you guys got it right here. There, 20 seconds is enough, right? Or 8 seconds. Bam! It motivates me just looking at it. Okay, so the inspiration, I'm gonna do this in metal. It's gonna be a metal counter. And the inspiration I'm gonna use is the existing walls or a door. Yeah, the door would probably be a good one. Level door, level door, north, 0 or 1. Let's look up 0. Yeah, look at this. What's up, Forum Levi? What is this site here? Sorry, man, I'm just kind of I've never seen you post before, so that's why I'm kind of I've been trolled before, like crazy bad, and so I don't click links that I don't know what they are. So what is this here? Nice, right on. Sheila Boo fighting away procrastinators. Oh wow, it's almost the exact same color. Okay, let's turn this one down a bit. So we've got like the background's kind of like this. Okay. So this counter, I'm gonna make it just a rectangle first for this counter. Imagining it's gonna be kind of long. Oh, let's get the player in here too. Sprites. Rock, here we go. Rock idol. North. What's up, Teeks? All right, cool. Now we got the player. We got a sense of height for what we can put for this counter. Let's draw it now. Oh. Yeah, let's save this first. Save as backgrounds. It's the Droid Smith. Okay, now we got this next layer. Let's draw this counter. Like coming up to maybe there, I guess, is really all it should be. Just do it. Oh, it looks kind of tall at that angle. So if the player is standing right by it, it's gonna come up to there-ish. Let's put the counter about like that. All right, so let's draw the top of it. Let's draw a highlight color, a little lighter. Huh. Nice. I gotta check these Shia videos out later. Maybe one more line, one more pixel. That was too much. Thanks, Electric Kyle. Thank you, man. Yeah, it gets better every day, you know. I get to be a better artist every day too. I just realize certain little things, you know. Okay, so the only problem with this, I just realized, is that. If the player places an item or whatever, I need to get the item actually in the graphics here. I know, right? Who'd have thunk it? Who'd have thunk? It's true. It's not like it's leaps and bounds or anything, you know, but. Yeah, day by day, that tiny little progress helps a lot. So let's grab the sword and let's grab like some other item and put them in here. I just realized they're both here. Okay. This is what it's going to look like in the game. It's just going to drop an item on the ground, basically. But we got to make it so it's going to look right. So. There we go, there's a sword. So, that's what I'm talking about. I need to do like maybe a notch in this counter or something. This is kind of how I want it to look. Like, there's an item here, there's an item there. Maybe they sink into the ground or something. Oh, I just got the idea. Cool. Right, I'm gonna draw sort of like a box that you put these in, and then they'll sink into the ground. Let's get the droid smith, the death looking guy in here for now. He's not actually what he's going to look like, but I just want to put some kind of other entity in this room to visually show where he's going to be. So I think, where the hell is that guy, the droid smith? Or shopkeep. It's called the shopkeep. Oh, maybe he's a foe. No, not there. Oh, a conveyor belt. Ooh. That's an idea. Smoke. That's an idea as well. Yeah. Items. Oh, he's in the items folder. Dude, I'm starting to get tired of having to do a find command when I'm looking for a piece of art. Shopkeep. So this is not what he's gonna look like, but I just want something there for now. Wine, totally. Yeah, maybe combine both ideas. Oh, it's so funny seeing him right there. What would you like today, sir? Yes, I do. I need some kind of better structure for that. They're all in these random folders. I don't know what folder's what. Why does it do that? It's trying to zoom in a tiny bit and it zooms in a lot. Okay, so let the imagination take over. What's up, Mike? I've heard of pixel edit. Ah, too bad I don't know the answer to that. I wish I could help you. Okay, I'm gonna get a drink of water while I think about this for a second. Whether to use a conveyor belt, smoke, some like boxes. I was about to use some boxes that would like sink into the ground and then the droidsmith would turn around and do some stuff, but I kind of like all these ideas. Ah. Okay, be right back. Monkey Island, cool. What's up, JFK? Felix? Such a crazy question. So Code Sparrow asks, here's a weird hypothetical for you all. If you were a Viking who had been banished to Helheim by Odin because you accidentally jostled him while he had a headache from drinking, what inconsequential slash humorous item would the trickster god Loki ask you to bring him out of Helheim in return for unlocking your cell? How about a key to hell? A pug? Yeah, I'm standing. Oh, I'm levitating. I'm levitating. That's yes, I'm gonna start saying that. The key, how about the horn of the devil himself? A special salsa dip. Oh, nice. Devil's finest Mountain Dew. Salsa dip, that's a really good one. Or some like Cholula sauce or something. Some shesh, what's that stuff called? Not Szechuan, but that, what's that red Chinese sauce? A paperclip? A devil's horn turns out to be a hot dog? Whiskey. That's another good one. What the heck? Sometimes Photoshop is weird. That's a great one. The Devil's Reject. Oh, whoa. Yeah, totally. It's even better, even more badass than the Addams Family. Nice. Oh, Nano, what's up from Hong Kong? How is it, man? How's the weather in Hong Kong? What time is it in Hong Kong? Isn't it like 7 a.m. or something crazy early? Come on. Of course, it has internet. Okay, something like this. $170 that side. $156. Is it totally off? 7 in the morning and hot, huh? Whoa. Yeah. Hong Kong, King Kong. Oh. Guys are hilarious today. Symmetry, symmetry, symmetry. On here we have 28 pixels. Over here we have 21 pixels, meaning 7 pixels need to change. Very good, sir. Okay, there. I kind of like this droid smith guy on the left. Yeah. Good idea. Good idea. Yeah, let's start doing that. I'll start adding some background stuff here in a sec. Okay, I want him to have some kind of workbench behind him, so he grabs your item, or somehow he obtains or whatever. He turns around and he works on his workbench. There's like sparks that fly and stuff. Whoa. Is it gonna be what kind of temple? Conan Barbarians? An ad for the last game. Oh. The awesome hilarities that could be put in here. And what's great is I can maintain the sort of quasi-serious vibe of this game, but then when you eat the cactuses and you get the psychedelic powers, it can change everything. You know, we like you could add whatever. I could add whatever. Make him dribbling a basketball if you eat a cactus in here, and maybe it gives you crazy good items, or allows combinations only when you do the cactus. Maybe they're bouncing bombs. Like they're orange, they look just like basketballs, but they bounce and then blow up, explode. Belittling drug abuse? What are you talking about? No way, it's encouraging. Check it out, man. Have you seen this yet, Momir? You can actually eat cactuses. They give you psychedelic powers. Oh, I don't have any cactuses. Hold on. This is what gives you the psychedelic powers to be able to see secrets. So if there was like a crack in the wall right here and I could bomb there, if I ate a cactus, I'd be able to see that crack. So this is kind of the catch-all thing to be able to like not only be able to do secrets, but also be able to do fun, hilarious, and just entirely playful stuff. You don't have to be little to do drugs. Yeah, I'm doing art for the Droidsmith today. It's the Cractus. I know, it makes me want to do it over and over. It's kind of his Cractus. Yeah. The Cractus. Hey, maybe, oh, that's an idea. How about if you if you use the cactus 4 times in a row, like the name of it turns into Cractus. So like it starts off as just a cactus, and then if you use it, if you abuse it, the name of it changes for forever for the rest of that gameplay. No, the water's not animated yet. I do have plans to animate it though with the shader. Yes, White Rabbit. Or an achievement. Yeah, there you go. I love the White Rabbit idea, and I want to do frogs soon too. Frogs, I love frogs. Frogs are a very psychedelic thing for me because I've always, in my psychedelic adventures, I've always encountered frogs. I love the White Rabbit though. It's so cool. We'll put down here Cractus achievement as well. Hypnotoad confirmed, for sure. I'm gonna make these crazy bright. Use a totally white texture or white pixels right here. So this is gonna really pop when it actually is in the game. This will be beautiful. But I want to show the ruler and show where 220 is. I think this is about centered. Okay, so since this is an evenly, this is all even, basically, this needs to be like that. There, that's where it needs to be. They do, some of them do. I've never tried that. But man, I'd like to. But not too much. I'm gonna try and make this look like a face, sort of. Yeah, totally, totally, totally. That's what I'm working on right now. I'm drawing this scene right here first, and then I'm going to animate him totally. So what he's going to do, he's not going to look like this either. This is just a total, not at all what I was thinking. He's actually going to be a robot, which he kind of has like robots like with like tools for hands almost. Like he doesn't even have hands. He just has tools, like laser tools and like saws and stuff like that. And he turns around, he takes your two items, he turns around, he goes back to his workbench right here, and either smoke appears or like sparks are flying off the item and stuff like that. He's like grabbing more tools and stuff like that, and then he turns back around and hands you the item or whatever. Something like that. That's the general idea for that this guy does. Oh yeah, there you go. Yeah. I was wondering what I was gonna put in the background. Like I'm feeling you there because I wanted to put some parts of something, like boxes and pieces of metal and stuff like that. But yeah, it's a cool idea to put pieces of jib in there. I love it. Yeah, and I really got some cool ideas for the procedural dialogue system. So that's a good idea. One of the dialogues will be Jib freaking out the first time you come here. You have to like calm him down, like, Jib, it's okay. It's okay, Jib. An apple with a little bite in it. All right, now that I've got a few like of these like ley line type things, I'm gonna add on some more, but that are more of indentations rather than just. Like energy. Oh, interesting. Yeah, I was trying to make the whole thing look like a face, so, and those were kind of his nostrils, but yeah, I could see what you mean. That does kind of look like a face down there too. Okay, so this stuff's really easy and fun. I'm gonna save this for later. I'm gonna focus on trying to create the rest of the scene with like, that stuff in the background, you know? Totally, yeah, let's give them some shelves on the back here. So we'll just have shelves of stuff. All right, man. Have fun at the temple, dude. Thanks. Appreciate it. I think it needs more pixels. I agree, Wolski. 100%. More pixels. What's up, Marengia? So in something like this, we could put like half a jib. Why isn't this copying? Copy merged. Paste. Oh, he's because he's behind that. I see. It's a shop. Yeah, I'm working on the shop, man. So this is where you craft items. So I've got the code part done. Now I'm working on graphics. This will probably take the rest of the entire day just working on these graphics and stuff. But while you're inside this droidsmith room, this is like down in a cave, you find this guy, and he's the droidsmith. He's not going to look like this. He's actually going to look like a robot. But you take two items, like for example, the blink orb and like the fire cube, and he combines them into the crafted items. So you got the fire orb, which is like a teleport thing you can use. So after you leave the droidsmith, you can go around and rock out your new item. That's it. So yeah, I'm just working on the code or the graphics now to get this looking cool. Yep, reboot. What's up, Light Thief? All right, man. Take care. Good night. Hazardous. Sleep is for the weak. I must be really weak then, because I need a lot of sleep. I think I sleep like 9 hours a night. Probably, I sleep like an unhealthy amount. Whoa, 48 hours straight? Whoa, man. That's crazy. I don't even know how you do that. It's hard for me to even go 24 hours. Yeah, wires, cool. Yeah, I was imagining some wires too, kind of like the refill thing. But wires coming out. Oh, of him. Oh, yeah. Good idea. Yeah, I was gonna do some little compartments first to do these to make these look more like cubby holes and less like a bookshelf. Nice, right on. Whoa. Yeah, some shelves with some stuff on them. No, it's gonna be the same perspective. Yeah, it's a good question because I am kind of using a more of a straight on, almost isometric perspective for the top of these things, but I think it'll look okay. In fact, maybe I should actually export this right now and see if this perspective is working before I go and finish all this art. That's a good question you just asked. Make sure this is right. So I'm gonna turn off the player. Just gonna export all this like that. Sheets, backgrounds, Joy Smith. Yeah, more from the stop from the top? Yeah. Yeah, let's put it in the game so we can see that perspective and see the proportions as well. Okay, I think that should put it in the sprite sheet automatically. I'm gonna check if the backgrounds automatically load stuff. Yeah, okay, it already has it. Yeah. Okay, so when we create the droid Smith. Hey, Sandwich, what's up, man? Right here is where we create the droid Smith. Let's put another entity. It's just a visual entity. We'll need a collision component for it as well. Yes. Thank you for reminding me. We all want sandwiches now. Give us sandwiches or we go. Okay, so this guy is collision. Oh, we need a separate collision for this. Yeah, separate collision at 220.66. And how big should this be? What's up, Arson Black? This thing should be about... Oh, I might as well make it the whole width of the screen. Height 15. Yeah, I'm good, man. How are you doing? Thanks, man. Okay, so now we've got those two things in. Let's see if this worked. Creates a droid smith. It's probably going to put the shopkeep at a weird... I might not... Oh, yeah. Threw it way over there. It's funny. Whoa. Back in there. All right. At least the collision box worked. So the render component for this guy... Oh, the position needs to be right in the middle. So 420, 210. This one should be 210 as well. Awesome. I love writing stories and lore. It's such a fun, creative part of game making. How's it going, Sandwich? What's your game about? Okay, we need to put these at the right places as well. We're like three or four layers, so no, I don't play Minecraft. Oh, it's a joke. Oh. Okay, so this guy, we don't need him exported as part of it. So we'll turn him off, and the rest is going to be slices. So I'll put one slice here in the bottom. Oh, cool. Sweet. Oh, it's part one, part two, part three. Is this part four or something? Yeah, part four. Yeah, three-quarter design. Nice. Sweet. I'm gonna go do this tutorial tonight. Yeah, this might really teach me a thing or two. I like seeing these cylinders too. Sweet. This looks like something that could really help me out, especially right now. How much time have I got left today? Oh, I'm already over time. Well, I'll do another 5 minutes. I'll at least get this stuff hooked up. A white flag? That's a good idea. Does he like surrender? Is he surrendering or is he surrendering for the both of you? Wow, cool. A nice man. I love it that there's a huge story. I don't know. Oh, that's the guy making Tower 57? Oh, cool. Okay, so I'm gonna make. All this is one layer, one slice. And then all the rest is going to be a slice too. All right, so I'm gonna name these two slices. This is like Droid Smith 1, Droid Smith 0. Yeah, because he's a coward. Dang, no saturation and pixelated? I'd be lost. Okay, so doing two different visual entities. See if that's about right. Oh, it's in beta. Oh, I didn't know that. Pixel edit. Okay, so messed a few things up here, but oh, what's up with that? Can't leave the room because that's down there. All right. This one's supposed to be, oh, position 68. Nice. Okay, now we're getting more like what it should be. We got two different pieces now. All right, cool. So, yeah, I think that's a bit out. That's about it for today's stream. I really want to go check out that tutorial, kind of try and up my art skills a little bit more. And then what I'll be doing is I'll really be playing with the actual, shading of everything too. There's obviously no shading whatsoever on these the counter or the background bench or whatever. And then I'm gonna be drawing the droidsmith himself and putting more stuff on those shelves and maybe adding another shelf and really bringing the whole overall scene to look better because the background rocks and everything are totally, they're not gonna be like that. So I'm gonna do a totally different kind of background as well. So lots more work to do on this tonight. I'll be working on this all tonight, maybe probably even in tomorrow as well. So paint.net, nice. So yeah, good luck you guys on all your projects you're working on today and stuff. And as usual, it's always fun hanging out with you. Yeah, totally. I'm trying to do more and more earlier streams. Thank you. I appreciate you guys. What the heck? Right then, Twitch gets all glitchy. What's going on?